tonight. Next week, bring somebody with you. Amen. Tell them you're going to take them out for dessert.
Amen.
You're about to get something to eat. Amen. You wouldn't really be lying, because the word of God is like food to the body. Amen. So we thank God for just his mercy and his grace. Amen. Most of us didn't have to be here, but we're still here. We're still in the land of the living. So nothing else.
Said we it was thank on, God had it on this. That.
Amen. We thank God for
still
the
gonna, it was still
music ministry tonight. Everybody that took part. Amen. Anybody feel a little bit encouraged tonight? Amen. 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 We thank God for the praise team and Reverend Manning and Reverend Deborah. I ain't gonna sing because, you know, I don't want to show my stuff, you know. Oh, no, I can't sing any of that, but, you know, with the power of the Lord, you can do anything you want to do. Amen. And if the Lord get a hold of me, I'll sing. Amen. Everybody might leave, but I'll still be in here singing. Amen. Let's look tonight, because y'all took up all the time. Let's look at Luke, the 5th chapter, which was read in your hearing. Amen. We want to look at verses 1 through 7 really quick and let it resonate in your spirit. The Bible says, and it came to pass that his people pressed upon him to hear the word of God. He stood by the lake of Gennesaret and saw two ships standing by the lake. But the fishermen were going out of them, and they were washing their nets. And he entered into one of the ships, which was Simon's, and prayed him that he would thrust out a little from the land. And he sat down and taught the people out of the ship. Now when he had left speaking, he said unto Simon, launch out into the deep and let down your nets for a catch. And Simon answering said unto him, Master, we have toiled all night and have taken nothing. Nevertheless, at thy word, I will let down the net. And when they had this done, they enclosed a great multitude of fish, and their net brake. And they beckoned unto their partners, which were in the other ship, that they should come and help them. And they came and filled both the ships, and that they began to sink. Brothers and sisters, I'd like to minister tonight around the subject, operating with elevated expectation. Amen. Operating with elevated expectation. My brothers and sisters, many of us have heard plenty of sermons surrounded by the subject of faith. And even tonight, as Reverend Scott began to sing, she sung a song about faith. Which simply means that faith is a very integral part of the Christian experience. The Bible teaches us that faith in Romans 1:17, that the just shall live by faith. Can I get a witness, somebody? And in 2 Corinthians 5, verse 7, it tells us that we walk by faith and not by sight. In Hebrews 6, it also says, without faith, it is impossible to please God. Can I get a witness, somebody? However, I would like to submit to you that many of us have faith, but we lack expectation. It's very important that when we come to God and ask him for something, that we should expect that God can and will come through. Amen. Expectation is something that creates the atmosphere for miracles, for signs, and for wonders to be performed. The writer, Christian writer, David Blunt, says this about expectation. He said, expectation is the magnet that draws breakthrough closer until it becomes a reality in your life. And often we never experience anything good from God because we never expect anything good from God. And what we need to do is we need to elevate our expectations. It's one thing to have faith, but we have to understand that faith and expectation go hand in hand. Y'all just stay with me a minute. I'm going to preach in a second. I'm trying to teach you something. In fact, expectation is the manifestation of professed faith. I said expectation is the manifestation of professed faith. In other words, when you profess that you have faith, the natural reaction is expectation. Amen, somebody. And if you are declaring it with your mouth, your actions reflect the fact that you are expecting it. Somebody ain't talking to me. I'll give you an example. The woman with the issue of blood. She was in that condition for 12 long years, but she had faith in Christ for her cure of her calamity, but her expectation caused her to press through the crowd and touch the hem of his garment. In other words, faith will open up the door. Come on, son. Faith will get you to where you're supposed to go, bring you to the door of opportunity, but expectation opens up the door for you. Somebody didn't hear me. I said that faith will bring you to the door of opportunity, but expectation will open up the door for you. Is there anybody in here that's listening to me? And somebody here today may not be receiving what they're asking God for because you really don't expect God to do it. I wish I had somebody up in here. I said somebody here today been asking God and asking God to do something, and you don't have it simply because you really don't expect that God can do it. Can I get a witness? In the text, we find that Peter and his partners are experiencing something called expended expectation. That's just a $3 word. That word expended simply means all used up. In other words, they have used up all their expectation. Come on, somebody. Verse number 2 tells us that they're washing their nets. They're done fishing. They're ready to give up. They're no longer interested. They're ready to throw in the towel. They're tired. They're unsuccessful. They have been a failure, and their expectations are expired, and they don't expect anything to happen. Can I get a witness? They are suffering from expired expectation because they have experienced failure. I said they're suffering from expired expectation because they have experienced failure. They fish all night long. They toil all night long. They look for fish and they labored for fish, but they caught no fish. And now their expectation is expended. It is expired simply because of failure. Somebody is talking to me. And failure will make you not expect nothing from God if you are not kept. Somebody ain't talking to me, but I know what I'm talking about. Just like these men, many of us have experienced something in our lives that caused us to operate with expended expectations. Something happened. You failed in this area. You failed in that area. Your marriage didn't work. Your career path didn't work. Your business didn't work. And now you are operating in expended expectation because of what you've been through, because of where you came from. Now you really don't expect God to do nothing for you. And in the text, we find that these fishermen fished all night. They toiled all night. They labored all night. They looked all night. They put their nets all night, but they caught nothing. And now they are operating with expended expectation. I wish I had about 2 or 3 people in here that understands what I'm talking about tonight. You ask God to do it for you, but you really don't believe God can do it because of what you've been through. You really don't see God being able to do what you need him to do. I know what I'm talking about. Faith by itself is not good enough, but faith mixed with expectation will open up some doors and make a way out of nowhere. Amen. Can I go into somebody? Well, when we look at the text, we find that Jesus is a master. I love Jesus because every time you have an issue, I have a problem, or there's a situation that's too big for you, you know what I like about the Lord? He always shows up. About 2 or 3 of y'all should have lost your mind because if it had not been for the Lord showing up in your situation, you'd have lost your mind. You would have snapped, crackled, and popped by now. But thanks be to God that he knows when to show up. And why these fishermen were operating in expended expectation, guess who shows up? Here he goes again. Always right on time. Jesus shows up and he shows them how to operate in elevated expectation. The first thing that Jesus does when he shows up, he, watch this, y'all need to write this down. I said, the first thing that Jesus does when he shows up, somebody's expectation of God is low tonight. Somebody been praying and asking and asking, and because God has not answered yet, your expectation is low tonight. And rather than saying, I ask God and I believe it, I'm expecting him to do something about it, because of the failures that you had in your life, you are operating on expended expectation. But I stop by tonight. The Master, Mary's son, Jesus, the Lamb of God, the wheel in the middle of the wheel, the bright and morning star. He shows up, and the first thing that he does to get them to operate in elevated expectation is he gives them a word. Hallelujah. That redirects their future. So somebody didn't hear me. I said, Jesus shows up. And he knows that they've been fishing all night. He knows they've been toiling all night. He knows that they've been doing the best they can. And Jesus shows up. And the first thing he does is gives Peter a word. Come on, somebody. At this time, Peter is at his lowest point. He's frustrated. He feels like he has failed. He feels unsuccessful. He's laboring all night long. He's looking for fish, but he caught none. And I thank God tonight that when I'm at my lowest, that Jesus will show up and release a word just for me. I wish I had a couple of them. And if Jesus comes and he releases a word to Peter, can I park here for a minute? You have got to be careful. Whenever you're at your lowest in life, you have got to be careful of what kind of word that is released in your spirit. I'm going to say it again. I said you got to be careful whenever you're at your lowest point, wherever you're frustrated, whenever you're vulnerable, whenever you're coming out of something that failed that you wanted to succeed. You got to be careful. You got to be careful of what you let in your spirit. You can't let anybody drop a word in your spirit when you're at your lowest. If you're going through a period of pain, a season of struggle, you can't listen to everything and everybody. You got to be careful when you're coming out of a failed situation. What you allow to be released in your spirit. I said you got to be careful. All your friends, you can't call them up on the phone, because all of your friends ain't got the word that you need to hear. Come on, somebody. You're trying to get better, not better. You're trying to move up, not down. You're trying to turn this thing around and not keep it the same. You got to watch who you talk to. You even got to watch some folk in the church.
Amen.
Somebody ain't talking to me, but I know I'm right. Can I get a witness? Watch this. Jesus shows up and Peter needs a word. And you know what Jesus does? Jesus speaks beyond his frustrations into his future.
Come on.
I'm going to say it again. Jesus speaks beyond his frustrations, and he speaks into his future. Notice, in order to give Peter this word, Jesus, first of all, had to climb into Peter's boat. Verse 3 says, in order for Jesus to give Peter this word, I'm ready to preach up in here tonight, Jesus had to climb up into Peter's boat. Can I go in? The same boat that Peter fell in. Is there somebody here who wants to talk to me? Jesus got in the boat, and I thank God that he's not intimidated by my failures in life. I thank that the Lord will climb into our failed situation and still release a word. I wish there was somebody here tonight that says there's nothing that can stop my God from releasing a word in my sin. Oh, God.
Come on, man. Amen.
Come on.
Lord, have mercy. Watch the Lord. Watch the Lord. The Lord releases. The Lord releases this word to Peter. Come on, somebody. The Lord releases the word. I thank God he's not intimidated by my failures. I thank God that he don't care about my failures. I thank God that the Lord had climbed into my failed situation and still released a word. God often, watch this, allows us to fall in life situations. Amen. To position us, watch this, y'all, to receive a word. Somebody ain't listening to me. God often will force us to fail so that he can feed us with his favor. God will allow us to fail just so that he can feed us with his favor. God will allow us to get in situations so that we hear his voice more clearly. If the boat was out there in the river, he couldn't have released a word. If they caught fish, he would have never been in a position to release the word. But God controls the fish. God controls the wind. God controls the wave. And God told the fish not to bite because I got a word for Peter. Can I get a witness somebody? Now watch this. It was not until after you failed, I messed up, that you really heard the word of God clearly. Okay, can I say that one more time? And see, sometimes God has got to allow us to experience failure so that we can hear his voice more clearly. Can I get a witness? It's only sometime when we have mistakes and missteps and mess ups in our life that we able to keep our ear to the voice of God, because when everything's going good, we have a tendency to void ourselves from God and think that we're doing things ourselves. But God is the kind of God that will allow you to get in a situation so he can position you to give you a word. Here's the word. Y'all want to know what the word was? The word was this to Simon Peter. He said, Peter, here's the word. I want you to push out in the deep. In other words, Jesus was prophesying to Peter. Amen. Jesus was prophesying to Peter, because Jesus told him, in other words, Peter, there's fish in your future. Somebody ain't talking to me. I'm going to say it again. Y'all should have got happy right there. Here they toil all night. Here they labored all night. Here they looked all night. Here they was fishing all night. And here comes Jesus, and he prophesies to Peter. He says, Peter, cast out in the deep, because you got some fish in your future.
Come on.
Somebody, you all look at your neighbor right now and say, you got some fish in your future. I don't care what it looks like now. Your net may be empty now. Your boat may be on the shore now. But I heard a word from the Lord. The Lord said, you got fish. Oh, God, somebody help me up in here. In your future.
Yeah.
Oh, y'all ain't excited. So let me tell you what fish represent. Just in case you're allergic to fish. Amen. Fish represent the things that you're looking and laboring for.
Amen.
Did y'all hear that? I said the fish represent those things in life that you're looking and laboring for. Come on, somebody. And the Lord sent me by here tonight to tell you that you got fish in your future. I dare you to look at your neighbor. Y'all don't want to look at your neighbor, but I dare you to look at him and say, listen, I don't know about you, but I just received a word from God that said I got fish in my future. Can I get a witness? All the things I've been looking for and laboring for, the Lord prophesied to me tonight, and he said, I got fish in my future. I don't know about you, and some of y'all can't praise him now, because the fish got to be in your hand, or the fish got to be in a frying pan. But I'm dumb enough and stupid enough to praise God in advance, because I'm praising him on his word. And I got fish in my future. I'm not going to wait until I get the fish in my hand. And see, that's the kind of praises we got. You got to wait until the fish is in your hand to praise God. Well, I stopped by to tell you I must be crazy, because all I need is a word from God. And if God says I got some fish in my future, I'm going to start praising him right now. I'm going to be like the psalmist. I will bless the Lord at all times, and his praise shall continually be in my... Come on and magnify the Lord with me. For the Lord is good, and his mercy endures forever. I got fish in my future. Might not look like it now, but I got a word from God. Can I get a word? I may be sick now, but I got a word from God. I may not have a job now, but I got a word from God. I may not have food in my cupboard and money now, but I got a word from God. I've been young and I've been old, and I've never seen the righteous forsaken nor his seed begging for bread. I may have enemies all around me coming up against me, but I got a word from God that there's no weapon formed against me, that shall prosper. I may not have it now, but soon and very soon, the reality of my expectation and my faith is going to be in my hand.
Thank you, Lord.
Watch this.
That's right, brother.
So in other words, we find out that Jesus gave him a word that redirected his future. Amen, somebody. And that's the way I can go through this low paying job. Because I got a prophecy. I got a word from God. Can I get a witness? That's the reason why I can come to church and not have no money in my pocket and still bless his name, because I got a word from God. And I'm blessing him on his word. Because the Bible says that he is a God that cannot lie. The Bible says that God's word establishes his character. And God wants us to know who he is. And if you got a word from God, you can stand on that word. You can stand and see the salvation of the Lord. You can wait on the Lord. Come on, somebody. The Bible says those that wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up like wings, like eagles. They shall run, come on, somebody, and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. Can I get a witness?
Amen.
So watch this. God has given Peter a word about his future.
That's right.
Can I get a witness?
Amen.
And if you're going to elevate your expectation, the first thing you need is you need a word that redirects your future.
Amen.
Can I get a witness, somebody? I'm going to give you a minute to write that down.
Yes.
You're going to go home and preach this to your neighbor. Can I get a witness, somebody? Preach it to your kids. Tell them you may not have what they got now, but you got a word from God. Amen, somebody. You got to learn how to spread the good news. Not only does the text suggest that you have to have a word that redirects your future, but the text also suggests that you have to have a willingness, watch this, y'all, to reject your failures.
Yeah.
I'm going to let y'all think about that for a little while.
Come on.
I said you got to have a word that redirects your future, but you also need a willingness. Y'all hear me? To reject your failures. Jesus tells Peter that there is fish in his future. Amen. Can I get a witness, somebody? And Peter has to fight and struggle with. We all have to fight and struggle with when we get in situations like this. In other words, Peter has to contend with the muscle memory of his mind. Because if you look in verse number 5, even though Jesus said there's fish in your future. Somebody ain't talking to me, but I feel like you're on the King's Highway.
Come
on. Jesus said there's fish in your future. Peter starts to remember in his mind. Come on, somebody. In verse 5, and he starts saying to the Lord, he pressed the rewind button on his mind, and his mind told him, you remember you was here last night, all night long. You toiled and you labored. You threw it from this side to that side. You tried this and that. You tried minnows and octopus and all types of bait, and you caught nothing. And Peter begins to speak to Jesus about his yesterday, and Jesus is trying, oh God, so Jesus is trying to speak to Peter about his today.
Come on now, preach.
Y'all know what I'm
talking
about. Y'all know what I'm talking about. Jesus already gave the word
that
is fish in your future. Immediately, Peter begins to press the rewind button on his mind, and he starts thinking about the last time on the lake. And as the battle begins in the mind. Can I get a witness? He starts talking about the last time on the lake, how he toiled and fished all night and came up with nothing. Look at this. Jesus is talking about this time. Come on, somebody. Has to do with the Lord's favor. And Peter's talking about last time, that has to do with Peter's failure. Somebody ain't talking to me. Somebody's still single here tonight because they're thinking about the last time. The last time I got married, it didn't work. The last time I gave my heart, it didn't work. The last time I was in a relationship, it didn't work. The last time I tried love, it didn't work. And what's happening is you're missing out on your favor, worrying about your failure. Can I say that again? I said you're missing out on your favor, worrying about your failure. Can you get on that piano and help me out tonight, brother? I said that you're missing out on your favor because you're still, come on somebody, worrying about your failure. So Jesus had to give him a word that redirects his future, but Peter had to have a willingness that rejected his failures. Somebody ain't talking to me. I said, the Lord never mentions anything about last time Peter's failure. If you read the text, the Lord never mentions anything about last time Peter's failure. Now your neighbor might mention about last time your failure. Your so-called best friend might remember about your last time failure. Your so-called spiritual gurus may remind you about your last time failure. But I'm so glad that when Jesus shows up and he gives you a word, he doesn't look at the last time, but he's trying to bless you this time. Is there somebody in the church that thank God that he's not bringing up the last time? He's just trying to bless me this time. Is there anybody here? You better open up your eyes and stop talking about last time and listen to what Jesus is saying about this time.
Watch this.
Jesus never, come on somebody, talks about Jesus never talks about Peter's failure. Jesus talks about his favor. Can I get a witness, somebody? And my brothers and sisters, one of the things that we got to understand is we can never get to the next time thinking about the last time. Y'all heard what I said? We can't get to the next time thinking about what happened the last time. That's immediately what Peter did. He had a fight with the muscle membrane of his mind. His mind said, well, what about last time? And Jesus said, I ain't worried about last time. I was in control of last time, and I'm in control of this time. And you will forget about last time and step over here on this time. You will see that I'm able to do everything but fail. If you will forget about last time and see what I got in store for you, as a matter of fact, Peter's eyes have not seen, ears have not heard, minds have not conceived the things that I have in store for you, Peter. Forget about last time's failures and concentrate on this time's favor. Peter had to have a willingness to reject his failures.
Yes.
Some people can't move forward because you still thinking about how you feel. And that's the act of the devil. He wants you to keep thinking you're a failure. Can I get a witness, somebody? And Jesus come in, he look at Peter, he know what they did. He ain't mentioned nothing about what happened last time. He just said, Peter, all I got to say to you, I don't care what happened last time, but there's some fish in your future. And Peter should have said, Lord, if you said it, then I ain't even going to talk about what happened last night. I'm not going to walk in the last night, but I'm going to walk in the right now. And if you said it, then I'm going to have some fish in my future. I'm going to act like the fish is in my hand. I'm going to hold the fish up symbolically to God and say, Lord, I thank you. Can I get away to somebody? Peter had to have a willingness to reject his failures. The problem is, how do you reject your failures?
Yes.
That's the question tonight. How do you reject your failures? Number one, it's very simple. It's elementary, actually. You have to admit that you failed.
Amen.
Amen, somebody. The reason why some of us can't move on from our failures is because we still haven't admitted that we failed. In other words, you got to say to yourself, I did have some setbacks. I did mess some stuff up. I had some mistakes and missteps. I confused the situation. But that was the last time. And now I got a word from God for this time. And I'm not going to walk in what I did yesterday. I hear Paul say, keep your eyes on somebody, forgetting those things which are behind and fixing your eyes. Come on, somebody. Oh, no, come on, somebody. And one of the things that we got to understand is we need a word that redirects our future. We need a willingness that rejects our failures. And I'm going to bring this to a close on this last point. We need a work ethic that reveals our faith. Now, let me just say this. We can have a word that redirects our future. We can have a willingness that rejects our failures. Come on, somebody. But without work, we ain't got nothing. Y'all getting quiet. Y'all know. I'm on a war path about work in the church. I said you can have a word that redirects your future. I said you can have a willingness to reject your failures, but you need a work ethic that reveals your faith. You need more than a word. You need more than willingness. But Peter needed to go to work. Things don't just get better. Come on, somebody. Just because you got a word and you got some willingness, you got to put some time in. Is there somebody in the church that know the Bible says that faith without works is dead? Can I get with somebody? Nothing will change without work. You got to have a work ethic that reveals your faith.
Amen.
So somebody said, what does this work involve? Watch this. I got three little things, and then I'm going to go to my seat and let y'all go home and think about this sermon. Number one, the work ethic involved for Peter. He had to go back to the same environment.
Wow.
Y'all like they didn't live there.
I think
that was deep.
Come on.
It was elementary. It was deep. I said, Jesus didn't send him to another water, a lake.
Yeah.
He didn't send him to a different place.
Yeah.
But this work ethic requires you to go back to the same environment somebody ain't talking to.
Come on now, preach.
Where you didn't catch nothing before. Yeah. Come on, somebody, because you need faith.
Yes.
To go back to the same.
Come on.
You need some faith to go back to the same environment where you toiled all night long and you didn't catch nothing. So the work ethic that revealed Peter's faith, it required that he go back to the same environment, the same water, the place of failure, the place of frustration, the place of unsuccess. Peter had to work to get what he wants from God. And some of us think God's just going to give it to us. But we need a work ethic that reveals our faith. Can I get a witness, somebody? Peter, Jesus said, I want you to get back in the boat. Come on, somebody. I want you to go to the same water that you was in. Come on, somebody. The same place where you experienced failure. The same place where you caught nothing. Peter, I need you to do some work. Go on back to the water. Not only did Peter have to go back to the same environment, but Peter had to use the same equipment.
All right, man.
Can I get a witness, somebody? Listen. He didn't have a new boat. I didn't mean a new boat. But that fit, didn't it?
Amen.
Y'all catch that one when you leave. I said he didn't need a new boat. He didn't need to go get a new boat. I mean boat. I keep messing up with that. He had to get in the same boat that he experienced failure in. Come on, somebody. He didn't need a new boat. He didn't need no. Can I get a witness? He had no new partners. He had the same disciples with him. Come on, somebody. And if we are going to operate in elevated expectation, there has got to be a work ethic that reveals our faith. Come on, somebody. We got to get in the same environment where we failed before, and we got to speak to the environment. If God be for me, who can be against me? No weapon formed against me shall prosper. Greater is he that's in me than he that's in the Lord. I'm coming to the same place of defeat.
That's right.
So he had to go back to the same environment. He had to go back to the same equipment. And last but not least, he had to go with a different empowerment.
Yeah.
Can I get a witness somehow? In other words, he was going back. His work was not to go back in your own power, but to go back in the power of the Lord.
Yeah.
And many of us don't have what we ask God for simply because we're trying to get it in our own power. We're trying to manipulate what we want. We're trying to scheme and devise stuff to get what we want. But we got to go back to the same environment with the same equipment. Come on, somebody. With a different empowerment, we got to understand that the Bible says it's not by power, nor is it by might, but it's by the Spirit, says the Lord. The Bible says when Peter went to work to reveal, come on, somebody, his faith, the Bible said that they caught so much fish that the net broke and the boat began to sink. And when God blesses you like that, you ought to call somebody and bless them real good. You ought to give to the poor. You ought to call your neighbor that don't even like you and give them the love of God and give them what it says. So no matter how many floors you got to walk at night, no matter how many burdens you got to bear, no matter how many disappointments that you got to endure, you got to remember the Lord says, fish in your future. You will be the head and not the tail. You will be the lender and not the bar. You will be above and not below. Look at your neighbor. Say, I don't know about you, but I'm operating in elevated expectation. Can I get one to stand on your feet tonight? Somebody here tonight been asking God.
God, my God. Thank you.
Had enough faith to open up your mouth and ask Him for something.
Yes.
But your expectation was love. And I come by to tell you that faith will only get you to the door. But expectation will open the door up and let you in.
Amen.
God wants us to operate with elevated expectation. Can I get a witness, somebody? I'm believing God that He can do more than exceedingly and abundantly more than we can think of or we can imagine. My expectation is elevated for this church. My expectation is elevated.
Amen.
I'm not settling for just the status quo church. I'm believing God that we can impact this community and our families and change lives and help people get their lives back together again, because I'm operating in elevated expectation. Is there anybody here that wants to join me? In your family, you ought to operate with elevated expectation. Them kids are acting up, acting crazy. Don't give up on them. Expect God to do something. Expect God to do something great. Expect God to turn it around. Expect God to pull it up and fix it up. I don't know who the Lord is talking to, but your failures have caused you to operate with expended expectation. Marriage may have failed. Jobs may have failed. Careers may have failed. Health may have failed. And because of what you've been through, your expectation is low. But God sent me by tonight to let you know that you got fish in your future. That thing you're looking for, that thing you're laboring for, that thing you've been calling on God for. He says that you have it. It's in your future.
Yes.
And my suggestion to you tonight is that you praise Him right now.
Yes.
Don't you wait till He manifests it, but you praise Him now.
Yes.
You say, thank you now, Lord.
Yes.
You say, I'm grateful now, Lord.
Yes.
I believe you right now, Lord.
Yes.
Doesn't matter where you come, because I heard your word.
Yes.
And I know that it's on its way.
Yes.
Old folks used to say, He may not come when you want
Him, but He's always on time.
But He's always right on time. And the word spoke to somebody personally tonight. I just want you to come up here with me if it spoke to you personally. Just come up here with me at the altar and it spoke to you.
My God.
You've been giving up on some stuff. Think that things can't work out. You've got to have an elevated expectation. Amen, somebody. For this fish, I know it don't look good now. I know you ain't got nothing to put in the pan right now. But if God said it, then that settles it. Everything you need is on this way. Because God said it. He said in your word tonight, be not dismayed. Can I get a witness, somebody? You got fish in your future. I don't care what the situation looks like. I don't care what the status quo says. I don't care what the report is. God says that you got what you need. That it's on its way. Operating, elevating expectations. I'm expecting the worst. And expect God to do great and awesome things. Expect God to open up doors that no man can shut. Expect God to level mountains that can't be leveled. Expect God to exalt valleys in your life. Expect God to make a difference this night. Reverend Riley, come on up and pray for us, will you please? Expect God to change some things. See, I didn't believe it, but tonight the word told me God's gonna make a way. Can I get a witness to somebody?
Father, we call on your name tonight because we know that you are able to do abundantly above all that we can ask or even imagine. And tonight we're gathered at the altar. We're gathered at the place where you said you would meet us. We're gathered in the place that you said you would put your name perpetually. And we're here because you have the answer. We're here because you know the situation. You know the circumstance. You know the condition. And tonight, God, we call on your name because your name is holy, because your name is worthy, because you're wonderful, because you're marvelous, because you're perfect in all of your ways, and all of your ways are worthy. And we call on you tonight because you are our God. Dominion.